We are here tonight for a special evening to celebrate the accomplishments of outstanding individuals who have made great strides on behalf of strengthening economic development in minority communities. The impact of these inductees is far-reaching and undoubtedly has made a difference in the lives of many of us here. We trust you enjoyed the reception and the opportunity to meet old friends and hopefully make new ones. We want you to continue to enjoy yourselves with dinner and the award program we have prepared. We all know this will be a night to remember.
Our awardees are people and institutions that have proven themselves to be trailblazers and pioneers in their own respected rights. And I think you will hear their stories, some from very humble beginnings, some from corporate prestige. Charles Safi, who I was very close with, he was my mentor, he was my example. He taught me how it was to exercise leadership, make decisions, don't look back, and do the best thing. Keep it, be moral in your decision making, be transparent, don't regret anything that you have done in the past, but never try to repeat the errors that you have made.
Our educational mission at the Foster School is relatively simple and straightforward. Our goal is to accelerate the leadership development of those students and professionals who put themselves in our care. We're thrilled at the opportunity to help the Hall of Fame in inspiring and empowering the next generation to become leaders, creating economic opportunity for people of all backgrounds. At the Foster School, we hold dearly the belief that education has the power to transform people, that people have the power to transform organizations, and that organizations have the power to transform the world in which we find ourselves, the world in which we live.
But for Charlie, being in corporate America, at Pfizer, 235 East 42nd, to say, what are we doing, and Phil, look into this, and then bring me some ideas back, and then let's go from there, was very, very different. I went on from there, and we dealt with that mindset, that corporate mindset of how do you break that down, how do you make it work on the minority purchasing side. Charlie was very, very unique in that process. And if we had the Charlies of the world, we wouldn't have had quite the problems we had. How do we break those barriers down? How do we put programs together, et cetera, et cetera? And people in minority diversity since then, for the last 35 years since then, I'm sure can have their war stories and talk about evolution since then. But to talk about this in 1969, 1970, and have a VP come down and say, what are we doing? Let's look into this and bring me some ideas and let's talk about this, was really, really groundbreaking, et cetera. And I think that's why, at least in my mind, he's always been a very, very special person. He then continued to work in minority economic development, et cetera. So these are just personal remarks, nothing prepared, et cetera, but they come from the heart. A young guy who was a little bit, broad in his thinking, but then having that person who came out of corporate America was at a VP level and could reach down and say, let's look into this, and look into this in a very positive way. And that was extremely unique. And we used that experience from Pfizer. I used that experience across when we put the purchasing council together around the country, that same kind of thinking to try to excite and interest his peers in corporate America, corporate purchasing America, 1970, 1971, do the same kinds of things. Without that background, without that kind of innovative thinking that came from a guy with credibility, that probably wouldn't have happened. So I'd like to bring up Charles Happy Jr.
When my dad stood in front of the powers that be and explained his idea as to how Pfizer could support minority purchasing, and in particular the National Minority Business Council, he stood there all by himself. He was alone in many ways. That took an extraordinary amount of courage, but it also showed a deep sense of empathy. When I learned many years later what he had done, I was really in awe. I was very proud of him, but I was not surprised at all. because years before that big day that he had at Pfizer, my dad had become aware that there were some foreign exchange students at Fordham University. My dad had attended Fordham and graduated there around this thing called World War II. So when he found out that there were foreign exchange students at Fordham that could not go home to their native countries for the Christmas holidays, he decided to do something about that. So one year, about 50 years ago, we had a graduate student from Fordham University, a mathematics graduate student by the name of Mr. Ed Pixio, who spent the Christmas holidays as a guest at our house. And my siblings and I, we were talking about this over the weekend, and even though, you know, I was probably in fourth grade, fifth grade, we all remember this very clearly, you know, and how he was quite a character. We learned a lot about the Philippines and about him. And then over the next couple of years, we had other Filipino students come in. At some point, we'd have three or four spending the holidays with us. So when I was growing up as a young boy, I learned three things about Christmas. One was, that's when we celebrated the birth of baby Jesus. And also, that's when there would be a well-decorated tree with plenty of presents. And there would also be, that's when the Filipinos were coming. You know, and that's just what we had, you know. I want to thank you all for bestowing this honor on my dad. But if you personally want to honor my dad, what you want to do is you want to give somebody an opportunity that they might not have if you weren't there. So thank you very much.
To the Minority Business Hall of Fame and Museum, to the University of Washington Foster School of Business, to the Office of Business and Economic Development, fellow honorees, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. My name is Mardine Michelle Purnell Hepburn, and my parents were two of the founders of Liberty Bank of Seattle. As has been said, Liberty Bank was the first minority-owned bank west of the Mississippi and the first of its kind on the West Coast. A very significant event happened here 46 years ago, almost to the day. Liberty Bank opened its doors May 31st, 1968. And to understand the history, we all have to remember our collective history, that Liberty Bank was part of the civil rights movement. And we are so blessed tonight to have two of the original founders here in the audience tonight. Liberty Bank was the brainchild of my father and these pioneers who steadfastly knew that the community needed their own source of capital. These leaders and the community had already given rise to credit unions in the 1950s, Sentinel Credit Union, NAACP Credit Union, and what is currently known as Northwest Baptist Credit Union. Then it was Mount Zion Credit Union, and Reverend McKinney founded Mount Zion Credit Union as well. So, but we have to remember that at that time, people of color could not just go to any financial institution and become a depositor or take out a loan. In the 1960s, given our history, it was difficult. And we knew, my father knew, my parents knew, these pioneers knew, that in order to create a sound community, we needed to be able to rely on our own.
You might know my dad through Kids Cameras. You might know him through Zones Incorporated. Or you might know him as the refugee from Kampala, Uganda, a place you may not know very well. My father came to Canada in 1971 following the expulsion of East Indians from Uganda. He had no job or possessions. He was only 24 years old. Even though so much of what he had in Africa was gone, he always emphasized the one thing that could never be taken away, education. And it is because of his education that he was able to rebuild a new and successful life after Africa. Growing up, my sister and I were blessed to watch our father raise his third and fourth children, Kids Cameras and Zones Incorporated. We watched him grow these companies with perseverance and drive, working what he likes to call half days. You know, the ones where you decide which 12 hours of the day you choose to work. He led these companies through ups and downs and to new heights. Throughout all that, he never forgot his value for education. When my father decided to create the Program for African Leadership at the London School of Economics, his alma mater and mine, we saw the beginnings of a new passion to increase opportunity and capacity of Africa's emerging leaders through leadership education. It was a program motivated to help lift Africa out of poverty through a new generation of leaders. I have learned so much from my father, but more than being a mentor, he is an inspiration. It is my father's commitment to education, which is one of the reasons I know how much this award means to him. It represents excellence in education, supporting the minority in the business community, and again, he is very grateful for this honor. And I'm grateful for the opportunity to be here with you all tonight. Thank you.
So there again, that's sort of the background of the history. My background is primarily, in terms of communications business. This is certainly a great honor because, you know, I'm now included in the annals with other great entrepreneurs, advocates, leaders, and role models such as George Frazier. George has been out there for a long time. Great guy, great communications person. But I'm an Earl Graves fan, okay? I grew up with Earl Graves at Black Enterprise. I was always one of those kids that read Forbes magazine, okay, Fortune magazine. Then when Black Enterprise came out, I said, glory, hallelujah, you know, because, you could relate to, something like that. I mean, because, you know, it resonates, it's like, okay, I can do this. And so that's sort of my background. I've always been an Urban League boy. Okay, raised in the NAACP. I'm just trying to give you some idea from whence I've come, okay? And it's really, really been good for me. Of course, and we look at all the other entrepreneurs and people that we've recognized, like Jesus Chavarria, okay? Harriet Michelle, Earl Graves. You just go on and on and on. So again, I'm very thankful. I'm very appreciative. As I said, this is the 50-year milestone, and the way that my life has worked out for me, it seems like it's working out in 25-year increments, okay? So I'm very optimistic about the next 25. God bless each one of you. Thank you.
My mother was, to say the least, tenacious, and she worked very, very hard at anything she did, even when I was growing up as a child. She canned fruit, and she attended PTA meetings, and she was den mother to the Boy Scouts, and she still found time to make my father a hot lunch every day and take it to him at work. And when she wasn't doing that, she was entertaining. She was just a type A personality. And she basically started working out of boredom when my brother and I went to school and we were busy with our after-school activities. Unfortunately, my father was then disabled in a motorcycle accident, and her hobby became a full-time job. She became a beautician, or so she thought, only to be drafted by one of only two black hair care companies in existence at that time in the 1960s. She quickly rose through the ranks to vice president, and then, as Carol said, seeing the challenges that face minority businesses, she became an assistant director at the New York, New Jersey office of the Minority Purchasing Council, and from there ended up CEO of the National Council. I didn't see a lot of my mother, and very often when I did see her, it was either in the back of a limousine or at a business lunch with five or six CEOs of various Fortune 500 companies. She worked tirelessly to make sure that minority businesses not only got a foothold in the larger corporate America, but that they stayed there. That was her goal, that they not only get in the door, but they stay at the table. And she worked very hard to make that a reality.